In the aftermath of the Chernobyl disaster, scientists faced a seemingly impossible task. They needed to place detectors into the destroyed nuclear reactor to gather crucial data on the processes inside. Yet, to be sure the detectors would even work, they first needed to gather at least some of this data beforehand. The problem was that this meant accessing the very heart of this. The radiation was certainly lethal. Sounds like a loop, but a solution was found. This is the first ever in-depth look at the story of Gamma-Visor. Developed right in the zone, this ingenious invention allowed scientists to literally see radiation from afar, creating visual maps of contamination across areas where often a human wouldn't survive even a minute. As usual, bonus reading for this episode you can find on our Patreon page. No pun intended, the Gamma-Visor was born at the maternity hospital of Chernobyl City. It is located not so far from the Bay of Famous Shipwrecks that many of you probably visited. However, in 1986, the hospital became the place where an expedition of Kurchatov Nuclear Institute was deployed. The expedition brought together many prominent scientists, and their task was to deal with the black hole the Unit 4 was in the early post-disaster period. So the Gamma-Visor was designed and built right here, same as many other technical solutions. So how did this device work? A centerpiece of Gamma-Visor is a radiation detector, but not a Geiger tube as you might expect. Instead, this was a matrix built from special cesium iodide crystals with a touch of thallium. This little addition makes a crystal glow when it's hit by a particle, creating a visible flash of light. This effect is called scintillation, and generally devices based on this principle are much better than those based on Geiger tubes. For the first Gamma-Visor, they made a 10mm thick matrix which had a diameter of 30mm, or slightly more than 1 inch. This allowed to accommodate 150 detection cells. Each was 2 square millimeters in size, and from each came an optical fiber which distributed the light to optical electronic converter. This element converted flashes into electric impulses and processed them. Then they were presented on a converter screen, and in result you get this kind of image, where brightness represents an intensity of radioactive emission. But described will work only if you are really close to the source. While the Gamma-Visor had to work at a distance of at least 200 meters or 650 feet. The problem is, at a large distance, as radiation travels through the air, it encounters Compton scattering. This is somewhat similar of shining a light through fog. Gamma rays get deflected off electrons in the air, diffusing their energy and making it difficult to get a clear image. So to address this, the Gamma-Visor was carefully tested in laboratory settings, where water tanks simulated that distance. Eventually, scientists found that they needed to add one more element, a particle collimator. It's basically a 10mm long tube made of uranium with 2mm opening. Think of this as a blinders on a camera or a pinhole camera opening, focusing only on the light coming from the target area. So similarly, collimator blocked scattered photons from other directions, ensure a crisp image by allowing only direct gamma rays to reach the scintillator. All of this was packed in a lead shield. For the first experimental portable variant, it was just 10mm or 0.39 inches thick. Once deployed on site, the device immediately proved its potential as a simple, yet life-saving innovation. But as you can imagine, pointing the Gamma-Visor at the target using only a pixelated image was quite challenging. To help with that, a combined display was added for the operator. Since gamma radiation can pass through almost anything, an optical lens was installed in front of the collimator, and the shape of the scintillation matrix was slightly modified. As a result, the screen displayed two images, an optical image on the left and a radiation imprint on the right. This very image, by the way, is one of the many examples where the Gamma-Visor literally saved lives. The bright spot here represents a fragment of fuel rod found at the 43-meter level, emitting a lethal dose rate. More sophisticated versions of Gamma-Visor soon were created. Upgraded models featured a 4-inch or 10cm shield and CCD sensors, which enabled them to capture live video feed. Due to their weight, these units were already mounted on vehicles and helicopters, providing a broad overview of radiation hotspots from above and aside, even through thin walls. Then, this data was processed on computers, offering essential information for the placements of detectors. And here is an interesting side note about relationships in the zone at that time. So, look once more. The scientist is working on a Western IBM PC. A few of these computers are supplied as technical assistants, and from what we know, this particular one belonged to Yevgeny Velikhov, a vice president of the Academy of Sciences of the USSR. Yet, he made it available for instrumental tasks. Well, in Chernobyl of that time, your position didn't really matter. It was all about getting things done. By the end of 1986, using gamma visors and already installed detectors, engineers had mapped the radiation spread around Unit 4. They identified two primary sources, the interior of reactor shaft around Scheme E and the reactor's northwest rooftop section. These aerial surveys provided essential data for tracking contamination around the industrial site of the power plant. But achieving remote visualization wasn't always smooth, and the solution was actually not universal. For example, take a look at this image from autumn 1986, taken from a distance of 200 meters. At the time, the surrounding area had already been decontaminated, and the roof of the sarcophagus was nearly completed. Yet, this bright spot indicates a powerful radiation source in the air above the reactor. But in reality, it is a phantom, it doesn't exist. But it appeared because at this distance, Compton scattering is so strong that the collimator cannot filter it out effectively. And additionally, when there are many small sources, such as high active dust, the gamma visor sometimes cannot provide a meaningful reading. To tackle these new challenges, a new generation of devices emerged, the gamma-locator. This device could not only pinpoint radiation sources, but also measure their power. Unlike the gamma-visor, the gamma-locator's detector was positioned at various angles and orientations, with the collimator alternately open and closed. So readings from different angles were input into software that mathematically combined them to calculate dose rates over a large area. This method wasn't limited to airborne systems only. For example, the gamma locator was mounted on a car equipped with processing hardware. In 1989, it was tested at the Poliski district, west of the zone's then borders. And it could locate contamination inside a 60-meter or 200-feet radius while on the move. Soon after, a portable version called CORAD was developed. It allowed comprehensive surveys to be conducted across households in Ukraine, Belarus and Russia. Special software was also created to produce detailed graphic maps from the collected raw data. What began as a solution born of crisis essentially became the blueprint for tools used all around the world today. This technology was drastically improved since then, and modern gamma locators allow to get a video feed with changing picture presented as overlay, somewhat similar to a thermal camera. And in the next episode, we will talk about those detectors which were placed inside the reactor with the help of described systems. But if you want to learn more about gamma visors and gamma locators, check out our Patreon page. There you can find bonus reading as well as truly unique insights, data and articles about Chernobyl often never translated before. This episode is a part of a series, so check out our other documentaries because we have many interesting things to watch. And see you next time in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.